Hey, sweet. I think that's all we need to do. Like that. All right, so Saffron's playing green-white enchantment. We want to die roll with our aggro deck, so that's great. No one drop, but the rest of our hand seems fine. Double Lord's hard to play. Yeah, Borrower's my only way to take enchantments off the table. I have may or may not want to bring Dispute in just to have more counterspells post-board. Tidebinder Mage is probably good here. He's got a bunch of green creatures. We have counterspells too. There's four Wizard Retorts in my main deck. We only have four one drops in our deck, so most of our turn ones are going to be land go. We'll see. I don't think my donation bar at the top is going to be too disruptive to being able to watch the content, but we'll see. I might adjust it if it's blocking things that are relevant. Read. So, Master of Waves here makes spells and abilities. This activated. Abilities your opponent, activate the target. Okay, so it wouldn't make things like Baffling and Crossbreaker. I think I still just play Cupola here though. And then next turn I can go Mistbinder plus activate Mutavault Smack for six. Pizza, thank you for your very generous donation. I appreciate that. It's hard to consider anything disruptive as covered, but oh, fair. All right, so Brazen Borrower. Think. So, do I want to animate Mutavault or do I want to hold up a bounce here? Think I'm going to go ahead and just animate Mutavault and smack them for six. With the plan being, hopefully, if they make this bigger, they attack next turn. Or they might just play defense with it. But I can always bounce it next turn and still attack. Yeah, the getting a dino is not super useful on this board, and they just get to replay the Baffling and Leap later. Yeah, bouncing to potentially push lethal is good. If they attack me, Harbinger is very good. Saving Borrower to be able to like end step, bounce a Sphere of Safety, play my thing, untap attack for lethal is potentially good too. Borrower is my primary means of interaction for something like that for a turn. We don't get rid of it permanently. We don't get rid of it permanently. We just take them off it temporarily. So this is only activated abilities, right? So like this doesn't actually stop this. That's super unfortunate. And they're playing defensively, which is smart here. This only bounces tapped creatures. Hey, thanks for contributing, Polar Scribe. How about we Thassa and then Biomancer? And I think just pass, just like take a turn off. Warden of the Ways is definitely something we cut here. It's basically a 3-mana 2/2 that's Texas because of the way their removal spells work. Yep, that's definitely their best card. You get to scry one every turn. So Sphere of Safety here, for those not familiar with some of these older cards. That's super unfortunate. This is creatures can't attack unless their controller pays X or X the number of enchantments they have. So gonna get mostly locked out here. I'm gonna go ahead and adapt this and draw a discard here. I don't know if I'm supposed to, like, commit a little bit more to the board before we Sphere of Safety. I probably don't want to be bouncing this until I have Lethal in play. I think I'm just, like, playing a 2-2 in passing. Is there a chat delay? No. No, this is a charity tournament. It's not like an MCQ or something like that. Mostly playing for pride and a good cause. And publicity, something like that. Are you an Animal Crossing kind of guy? I don't know. My wife bought Animal Crossing. She's playing it with Declan upstairs, so I'll probably play it with him at some point. It involves a lot of reading. This is game one, and they drew both copies of Sphere of Safety. So if I don't draw another Brazen Borrower here, I'm probably just going to concede. Oblivion's End Gaming, thanks for the third of a year. I appreciate that. Welcome back. Jay Miller, thanks for the 15 months. So this is their best card in the matchup, and they play exactly two copies of it, and they had both copies in the top, 16 cards of their deck. That's kind of how Magic goes sometimes. Weather Lady, thank you for the 14 months, I appreciate it. Are you streaming tomorrow too? I am. So tomorrow is going to start my shifted schedule. I'm going to be live on Saturday and Sunday moving forward, and taking off 2 days during the week is the plan. Yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and concede. This game's pretty done. I drew almost all of my cards that are bad, and we're gonna board out here. Like Harbinger of the Tides is real bad. Master of Waves basically doesn't have a text box. We're gonna bring in our Tidebinder Mages because they have a bunch of green creatures we wouldn't mind tapping down. And then honestly, I'm just gonna bring in a couple of Mystic Disputes. It's just like bad cancel. Just like 3-mana counter target spells real, real good. Any idea which 2 days off of the week it'll be? I think it's going to be Tuesday and Friday. Kirstie says, Declan isn't appreciating Animal Crossing because he keeps clicking through things before she can read them to him. Sounds like a 4-year-old. Yeah, I don't think Weaver's very good here. This is like an extra card for when they have a lot of creatures in play. It's like we don't have Marrow Regery in this format, so we have to play this card. It could be right to even like fit in the other Mystic Disputes, but I don't know if that's really necessary. I'm just gonna go ahead and click submit like this. I'll have 6 counter spells, and then our 4 Brazen Borrowers. Maybe I should have put some kind of Naturalize in the sideboard. I don't know. There aren't a ton of enchantments in this format, so like running into a little bit of an awkwardness against a brew. They have exactly one card that we care about, and they just like happen to draw 2 of their 2 copies in the first game, so. I actually kind of surprised his configuration isn't playing more Sphere of Safety. When I've played enchantment-based decks in this format, that always feels like it's like the single best card in the deck, as was exemplified that game. I still plan to post my schedule up front the week before Genesis Protect, so this week's definitely going to be Tuesday, Friday, and then, depending on what viewer counts look like on the rest of the days, I might adjust and try some different things. My plan is to still do the same volume of Magic content I've been doing, just on slightly different days. Morning, Dabber. Hey, Puffic. Thanks for the contribution. I appreciate it. We cleared my match amount, so that's great. Is there a counter for the donation totals of all streamers? I don't know. So everybody that's taking donations is on like a team through this Tiltify site. I'm not sure if it tells us exactly how much in total is raised. Oh, is my counter? No, that counter is just for Hoaglandia. Though, sorry, you're saying the one is the one on my screen for all streamers. So that's just a Hoaglandia counter. I don't know if one exists for everyone together. That total at top should be just Hoaglandia donations. Hard to pass up a hand with two Silver Girl adepts here. 2-1 Elvish Visionary is pretty busted. So this card standard was standard legal, now historic legal and pioneer legal. Draws a card when it comes into play. It costs 3 more unless you reveal a Merfolk when you cast it. Hey Dauber, thanks for the contribution. What made you pick Merfolk? I just wanted to play something kind of aggressive that had some interaction in it still. And Collected Company, while it's a little bit of a high variance card sometimes, it's a good catch-up mechanic. So like, the archetype kind of does everything I look for in a deck, even if I'm not a huge fan of Collected Company personally. I was between this or the Sultai Reclamation deck, and I just decided that, like, with everything that's been going on and, like, scattered mental state, I just didn't feel like playing a deck that required as much engagement as Sultai Reclamation does. Zaparis, thank you for the very generous $100 donation. I appreciate it. So we'll get this Silver Gill adept down here, and then we'll probably just hold up Mystic Dispute for the rest of the game. The key Mystic Dispute turn is going to be when they have 5 plus mana. So that way, when they have 5 plus mana, so that way we can counter Sphere of Safety, which is their single best card against us. Their individual removal spells are obviously relevant as well, but the one that really matters that we want to stop is the Sphere of Safety. Yeah, so Collected Company doesn't cast the cards that it gets, so it just puts Brazen Borrower directly into play. Is the whole tournament for charity? I think there's like some booster boxes as prizes, but I think most people are going to give those away to some random person who donated. That's probably what I'm going to end up doing. Have them mail it to someone that contributed. Yes, this is Ted Anderson's tournament they put together. Strong set on Twitch. Good afternoon, Bob. Let's see what they got here. They have Wolfwallow Haven in play as this enchantment, so they currently have 4 mana total. They have a good amount of pressure in play here. Yep. So, I think I might just offer the trade here. I should have played the land. Yeah, I probably should have played the land. I'm just going to go ahead and attack rather than use the Tidebinder Mage. If this stays in play, it sits there and draws cards. So, if they want to trade, I think I'm okay with trading. So I have 2-1-1s here, but I can adapt these if they block it. If they don't block here, I'm just gonna let them take 6, and I'm gonna play the land and pass. And then if they don't play anything worth counterspelling, I'll probably double adapt. But especially since I have 2 disputes and a borrower here, I'm going to dispute, like, pretty liberally, I think. No, the bounce spell is super valuable here. The bounce spell is there, like, exclusively to take Sphere of Safety off the table. It's, like, the one card we really care about. Banishing Light. Yeah, I think I'm just going to counter this. Yeah, everybody playing in this thing is streaming their perspective. So if you're someone at home watching and you, my friends Benjamin and Grant convince you to play some Slay the Spire soon. They definitely can, Punchworthy. Thank you for the very generous biddies. All right, so now I think I just do this, tap their thing, and smack them for six. Sorry, to complete my thought before Punchworthy dropped a bunch of bits. Everybody playing in this tournament today is streaming it. So if you want to watch any of the things that are going on, you can pull them up from both perspectives. It says post board. Yep. Yeah, I brought in two disputes out of the board. And honestly, I might want more disputes even. So what is this sideboard of anything that I should worry about? No, it looks like just sphere safety is the only thing I really care about here. Gosh, do I want all my disputes in post board? I might want all my disputes in post board. Dispute felt like really good there. If you like the games where we see a couple of counter spells, we're probably gonna be in a good spot. Is it crazy to trim a Thassa and bring in a dispute, another dispute? I feel like it's probably not. It's going down to 26 creatures. Feel like that probably makes sense. Tapping out for a three feels a little scary too. I feel like the games where we keep their Sphere Safety off the table. Oh, trimming a Coco with the lower creature count? Yeah, maybe. I don't know. So, like, Coco, it has the really high upside of, like, being a threat while also holding up disruption. Which is great. Sure. Not amazing, but fine. Fantastic. So we just like want to draw two lands in the next like three draws. Can we convince them to play poker? Maybe. Perfect. Oh, I get a redraw with this too, right? Poker is such a dry game to watch and play efficiently. I played a lot of poker during undergrad, and part of the reason why I stopped was the gameplay is just not particularly engaging if you're playing it well. There's a lot of folding if you're playing poker optimally. Sandals, I just want to say thanks for streaming. I'm an emergency responder and stressed with the newborn at home. Appreciate your videos. Stay safe out there. Thanks for all you do in this crazy time. Hope as many people as possible stay in. Sumedan, thank you for the 333. Coming in hot. Yeah, social poker is fun for the social part, not quite the poker part. Agree. Galix is pretty good. I think I take this opportunity to deploy these two and just cross my fingers for no sphere safety. If they hit sphere safety, there's a good chance we kind of lose the game on the spot, but I also think we're gonna lose if we just like sit here and like hold up interaction with no pressure in play. So they have a lot of looks here. They bring in a third sphere safety post board. They also need the late untapped land too, I suppose, but they're pretty likely to have that. Big difference the play versus the draw make with the tempo deck for sure. For people that are still working during the week and you're going to enjoy a little bit of Magic on the weekends, I'm going to be streaming on the weekends moving forward while we're in a state of insanity. So every Saturday, Sunday, you can expect to see from me now. Although most Saturday, Sundays, they're going to be my normal daytime hours, like 8 to 2 or 3, 2, 3, 4 o'clock, as opposed to this afternoon segment like I'm doing now. So starting tomorrow, I'll be live at 8 a.m. The Mad Tipper, thanks for the year and a half. Welcome back. Why do all these cards have borders? They're so contained. Yep. So I think I'm supposed to do this, tap their Eidolon, kill their Galix. I'm going to decline to activate this and miss a point of damage to bluff a wizard's retort for the turn. I don't like the graphics update for Arena, so 90s. That's fine, deal. Oh, we're playing against Saffron Olive here of MTG Goldfish fame. Baffling End, yep. So I assume we're going to see them take the Tidebinder Mage that just came into play. Yep. Well, there's the retort we were talking about bluffing. I'm going to ditch the Thassa. I feel like I want... Maybe I'm supposed to ditch the Dispute there. They have 7 cards in their hands. Like, we kind of just, like, have to run them down at this point. We're not going to be able to go long here, which is always kind of the expectation, right? Huh? So, let's go Tidebinder Mage, tap your Eidolon of Blossoms, smack you for 4. And then we can retort something next turn, because these are wizards. And then we can Mistbinder and hopefully kill them. Over the course of a couple turns. Oh. It's an Eidolon of Blossoms. It's a 2/2 that whenever an enchantment enters play under their control, they draw a card. Yeah, they're gonna snowball really hard, really fast here. Probably gonna end up being a little bit too slow on the draw here. Counter the removal spell here. Maybe I'm supposed to save that for Sphere of Safety, but I also feel like I just like need to use my mana here. Like we're not gonna beat them on cards. Mana efficiency might be an axis we could win this game on. Like they're also spending all of their mana each turn, so that's probably unlikely too. Yeah, we lost game one because they drew. Saffron drew both copies of their main deck, Sphere of Safety, and locked us out. And then it looks like we're going to be a little bit too slow on the draw here. So they currently have 4/8. They have up to 9 mana this turn. So it's Mystical Dispute. Not going to counter Sphere of Safety here. Yep. There's like drawing 3 cards per thing now. Yeah, that's good enough. And now we wait for an hour. I gotta figure out how to report on this thing. It's probably easy. Website seems pretty good. Well, this website's great at least. That's nice. We're using a website that actually is designed for Magic tournaments instead of like something like Smash.gg. Yeah, Marty. I mean, I wouldn't be here doing Extra Magic Online if it wasn't for a good cause. I thought about doing something on my own. I was like, if they're already putting this together, might as well just participate. I guess I could do... I guess we could just play a league in between. They probably have time to play a league in between, huh? We could also finish my dungeon run in Keeper. Keeper of the Legend. Legend of the Keeper, whatever it's called. Let's join a league. Let's play a little bit more Magic in between. Nah, I really don't want to like I can't do donation decks in between because then they'll be cut up and stuff. So let's just play some more of this. I don't know. We're probably gonna like 0-2 or 0-3 the actual tournament and be done after a few hours. Nah, pulls suck. I'm just gonna make a decision. Asking Twitch chat. What they want to do is like asking Christy what she wants for dinner. You just never get a straight answer. Much better off just making a decision. Zach and Afane, thank you for the quarter of a year. I appreciate that. Welcome back. Thanks for keeping me around. Cannon Spectacle, thank you for the 5 months. Happy Saturday. What do you want for dinner? I don't care. Offer suggestion. No, not that. Well, you said you didn't care. What's the deal? All right, we'll have a tribal off. It's a good pickup. There's a strong possibility that our deck's just a bad version of Spirits. This is the other game. If we scrub out of the league too and we're still playing in the actual event, we're probably gonna play a little bit of this Legends of the Keepers game. We did a sponsored segment with them the other day and it was fun, and I didn't finish my dungeon in it yet. I don't really want to learn a new game Punchworthy. It sounds like extra work. I can't block now. I can't attack now because they'll just block. This is, This makes our collecting company bad too, which is extra unfortunate. Their one drop is so much better than ours. Not having a curse catcher, and like their curse catcher like flies and gets bigger when they play other spirits. That's so good. Alright, let's play Merfolk Trickster and tap their eagle here and smack them for three. Although they have more lords than us too. This deck's probably just a bad version of spirits. Psychologist, thanks for the year and a half. I appreciate that. Welcome back. Like I said, nothing in Pioneer's really like spoken to me of late, so I just like picked a random deck that we'd played in the last 2 weeks. It's been a long time since Merfolk wasn't just the worst version of another tribal deck in any format. Fair. Regret is setting in having... Yeah, we're just super dead, right? Regret is setting in having registered it for a league. Because we set $10 on fire to join the league. I actually just, like, don't have any sideboard cards here. That's not strictly true. Mystic Dispute's fine here. Vivian Champion of the Wilds gives Vigilance, which may or may not be useful. Probably not, but we'll think about it. This doesn't seem very useful. They don't really have removal spells. It does give reach. Yeah, reach. I said vigilance. It gives reach is what I meant. That might be okay. I don't know. Like, it's probably not actually very good. It's like, they just, like, attack her. Like, I can't really defend her, and their creatures on average are, like, bigger than ours. I guess this format's kind of fast and brutal too. There's a real chance that there isn't much downtime between rounds. Someone in the Discord server said there's only 3 matches not reported. Although if Gabe Nassif is playing in one of the 3 matches not yet reported, we could easily take the entire time. Sure. The record command has never been as relevant as it is today. Gosh, it just seems unwinnable. Afternoon snowstorm. Let's just chill out till the next match. We'll probably play some more of this league in between, but I'm not gonna start lose another match on the in between for now. Maybe it seems unwinnable because it is strong possibility. Hey, Appletoons, thanks for 28 months. I appreciate that. Welcome back. I'm doing all right, Seth. Hey, not protagonist. Thanks for the 20 months. I appreciate that. Thanks for keeping me around. I think I'm gonna play some of this in between rounds. So it was neat when we played last time. This is something I can pause and put off to the side because it's a single player game. So it's not a deck building game. It is a it's called a roguelite game. Hey, Just Pert, thanks for your contribution. I appreciate that. I'm going to go through a couple of these things really quick. I'll show you where the actual gameplay is. There's, like, things that go in between. This gives extra armor. This gives resistance. This gives speed. I can do multiple. That's great. Enjoying watching the streams this week while I work from home. Normally I have to watch on YouTube. Well, glad to hear you're able to stay safe and still stay employed. That's good. Thanks for the 3/4 of a year going hog wild. Choose a task. Seminar. Sanctuary. Oh, it's Legends. The suit and tie vampires are here to collect taxes. I can pay blood and get extra money. Deal. Sell monsters in the garrison that are no longer useful to you. Yes. I would love to sell some of these idiots. I think that guy's okay. All right, so the actual gameplay in this is, I didn't use the garrison after the last time we played. I should swap her out. So the actual gameplay in this game is it's kind of like a tower defense game with progression elements to it. So you're like a you're the bad guys, and you're like setting up traps and monsters in a dungeon to beat the adventurers that are coming in. And I tell you what their stats are, and you have to pick from your selection of traps and monsters based on what their stats look like. So like these things have kind of bad armor. And this deals physical damage, and then applies bleeding. So I'm gonna start with the circular saw in the first room. Then we can put some monsters down. Passive. So this guy, normally the positioning of your monsters is really important, but this guy shuffles them in the first fight. So my positioning's not super relevant. Because they're gonna shuffle some of my things. These are all pretty resistant. Actually, these are resistant to nature. These first two, so probably don't want a nature guy. This thing does fire. This does air damage. I'm gonna put another trap here. My second set of guys has a bunch of fire guys in it, if I recall. Yeah. guy at the end. Alright, so this thing, normally your guys can have like a couple of different attacks and you have to pick between them, but this guy only does a bite. This does air damage to everything in morale, or it does sharp horns to the front one. And you can see when you mouse over it, it kind of shows you how much damage it's going to deal by minusing their life totals. Just kill the front guy. My poor little skeleton puppy. There's one of our adventurers down. This is just the front one, this is both of them. Let's get them through. My dad was complaining that everywhere was shutting down around him and there weren't any cases in our county. As he put it, I had to explain how a virus infection venture worked. Yeah, it's kind of like a reverse Darkest Dungeon. This is the spell room, so you get to like hit them with whips. These guys actually died really quickly. So I attacked them with a heat wave. Yeah, pretty cool. Actually, didn't even get to my second round of monsters. Electrical coil. Slaveholder. Yeah, let's upgrade my guy. Weather works. The local hospital and told me to drink hot liquids frequently. That will wash the bacteria down your throat and destroy by your stomach acid. I'm not sure how science-y. No, that's bad info. You should stop spreading that. That's like Facebook. Like Facebook wall posts. That's some bad pseudoscience there. Drinking. You should drink water, because water is good for you, but like, please don't tell people that they're gonna be fine if they just like drink hot water, because it's just like, that's not. None of the actual scientists have said that. Yeah, that's if you hold your breath for 10 seconds, you don't have it. BS. That's a good one. If it's not something the CDC recommends on their website, don't recommend to their others. COVID is a virus, not a bacteria on top of that. Yeah. Can upgrade some of my monsters. If you pour molten lead down your throat, it'll prevent you from getting the virus. That's technically correct. Is this Raid? No, this is a game called Legends of the Keepers. It was an indie game that we did a sponsored segment with last week or the week before, and I wanted to finish out my full week of the dungeon. Needed. This is a single player game that I could play in between. Suppliers offering you some human thighs to feed your employees at a discount price. It would greatly reduce your feeding expenses, and you know the management would grant you a sweet salary bonus. Deal. Thick thighs save monster lives. I would love to plunder. Yummy human thighs. Yeah, the Vorthos in this game is something else. I wanna plunder. I wanna plunder the monster's lair. Nothing terrible could happen because of that decision, right? To deal with office troubles. This is the champion at week 52, so let's train up. I think I wanna train the squad here. Let's get them as absolutely swole as possible. It's correct. It's not cannibalism. Our characters are monsters. Do I have all of my favorites in here? I think so, because it's like the last round. Oh, I want the poison guy in here, probably. I like this archer guy. There's still one match left going in the tournament. Alright, so these guys are... This guy's weak to nature and fire. Weak to nature, fire. Weak to fire. Oh, these guys are perfect for us. We have a ton of fire guys. So we're going to lead on the poison dart. This guy's weak to nature up front. I'll be surprised if they even get to my last dude. What are their passives? Deals ice damage when he kills a monster. Reflects 20% damage taken as fired. Ignores the first attack suffered. Heals 50%. This is a healer in the back. How's the tournament going so far? We lost round one to Saffron Olive playing enchantments. Him up front because he's big and he's angry. And all these guys are weak to fire, right? Yeah, so just put all my fire guys in. Gives him a little poison. Poison stack up, which is great. Toxic Valley gives them all a little poison. Apply a little bleeding. Again here, just spread a little poison out. Because the poison modifiers stack up, and these guys are likely to run all the way down to the end of my boss. Have a little bit of poison, you know, as a treat. I have an item that when my monsters die, they might randomly pop back up as a skeleton. Although, that skeleton didn't do a whole lot. This is my burning oil trap room. Hit them with the fire weakness. Watch it. Light them up. Do 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 do. Alright. Stalactite falls, deals damage, it gives them frostbite. Makes them all slow. Let's slow down. Let's slow this down. Channeling by Hitter Teffer, right? So Fireball does 60 to the one in the back. It's pretty good. Field of the Dead just deals morale. They just deal the one in the back. You Persecution does 35 fire damage, adds stacks. Spontaneous Combustion does 35 fire damage, stacks burns. This kills the back one, right?
Yeah, it does.
All right, Chunky Monkey, I believe in you. Look at that. Didn't even get to my guy at the end. Afternoon, folks.
Good work. We'd like to offer you a promotion.
Promotion? I've been playing games with the kids lately. If you're ever a fan of Peggle style games, I've been enjoying Round Guard on the Switch. That's not what I've heard of. I'll have to add that to list. Choose one of these constraints. Employees placed in the third monster room are vulnerable. Employees placed in the third monster room are tired. Employees placed in the third monster room are slow. Probably vulnerable. Okay, so when the year finishes, it gives you a bonus, then you roll through it again. You get to keep leveling up your guys. How the fishes look? Underwhelming. My pseudo sweet pioneer deck has not been impressive, believe it or not. I know this is gonna shock you, but my non-tiered pioneer deck's been a little rough. We lost to Saffron, and then we joined a constructed league and we lost to Spirits. The last match should hopefully be done soon. Surprise Pikachu face, yeah. So I was going to just pull up their commentary, but Bloody's pop-up animation notification apparently has a a song associated with it, so probably don't want to do that on my channel. I prefer not to have copyrighted content playing. Looks like they're playing a mono black mirror. I can actually pull up deck lists here. We have all of the decks. Bloody. Looks like they're playing Vampires with a small devotion sub theme. And then Kvartek. Is also, because they're both playing Vampires. I could try and mimic their commentary, something like that. It doesn't look like there's a whole lot going on here, right? Like the Kali toss on this board can't attack, or it can. I guess if they trade it here, like they're obligated to, they gain enough life to be able to start drawing cards with their castle, which puts them up ahead. And like while it trades the 2/3 for the Kali toss, they get a 2/2 out of it. Yeah, this attack makes sense. Thanks for contributing, Niv. I appreciate it. Oh, and they just had another Galitos in hand. Yeah, this game should be super done. Like paying two life to draw cards, they just like need two spells to get out of this. That is not a particularly useful spell shape, and the Dusk is lethal here, so we'll see. We'll see what game they're in. Champion of the Dusk, when it comes into play for people that don't remember, makes them lose life equal to the number of vampires they control. They might have drawn the Sorin with the castle draw. So they drew, Kvartek drew with castle. Kvartek drew with castle before. I could pull up Bloody Stream directly, technically, here, right? So the last match. And then I don't have Todd and Bloody on the screen for us. Don't know if I have Bloody on my list of follows. It's a charity tournament, Greg. So, like, anybody ghosting in a charity tournament, like, anybody ghosting in general is kind of scum, but, like, nobody, like, we're playing for, like, the cause and, like, for bragging rights, not for anything super meaningful. I think there's some booster boxes are giving away as prizes, but mostly just people trying to stream some stuff since there's not tournaments going on the weekends with all the COVID-19 lockdowns going on. Willem, thanks for the 27 months. I appreciate that. Welcome back. So keeping me around. Legion's end here. So they have fatal push. Kvartek has fatal push to keep the knight off the field. But not a whole lot of pressure themselves in this Mutavault, I guess. If Bloody runs off some lands here, they're probably in a pretty good spot. It's a shame Wizards doesn't have Arena Tournament ready yet. I mean, we could theoretically, like, what we're doing today with Pioneer, we could do this with Standard or Historic on Magic Arena. Like, we're running this Magic Online Tournament through a third-party website. But yeah, as far as, like, Grand Prix go, like, the fact that, like, Channel Fireball is going to run, like, ad hoc tournaments through a third-party website with entry fees sounds, like, really clunky. Hopefully it ends up working out smoothly for them, but my optimism is low. Having seen what 60-player Twitch rival tournaments look like, Cypress, thanks for contributing to the COVID Relief Fund. Build your own tournament functionality and arena should jump to the top of the right. I know. Yep. That was part of the reason why it was sad that, like, Artifact ended up being a dumpster fire in terms of gameplay. Because, like, the software surrounding Valve's Artifact game was so good. Like, you could run custom tournaments and stuff in there. It had a full-on tournament mode and everything. It's just, like, the actual gameplay itself was just god-awful. Is the random screaming and ambiance music from the Legends badge, should I turn it off? Did Arena pick up anyone on the Artifact team? I don't think so. Hey, Float Mana, stay safe out there. How are the hospitals by you? Heard East Coast and West Coast are getting fairly hammered at this point. The random screams are channeling the current state of Pioneer. I'll just exit this for now, actually. I just wanted to see what happened when you finish out the 52 weeks. Yeah, I don't know what the state of COVID type stuff is in Atlanta. I know New York and I think the Seattle area was rough from what I had heard. Hey, what's going on, Gemini? We're gonna be here for a little bit at least. I plan to play at least we'll play to at least 0-3. If we win a match or two, we'll play all five. There's 16 players, so it's 5 rounds of Swiss. It's really bad in New Orleans. Yep. Perfect, not protagonist. Helps keep things consistent. The hospital I work in Ohio got its first confirmed case. The clinic's been overflowing, though, so likely soon to be worse. Yeah. The original projections I was looking at a week ago when Christy and I decided we wanted us to, like, self-quarantine and lock ourselves up. Or social distance, right? If you're not sick, it's called social distancing. Quarantine is if you're sick. When we decided we wanted the social distance, projections that a number of hospitals would likely be overwhelmed by the 23rd. Yeah, I saw an article that for places like New York and some others, they just don't even need to be testing at this point. They just need to, like, because the point of testing is to, like, try and stop the spread. But, like, in places like that, the spread is just so much. They just need to, like, put everything on lockdown regardless. Yeah, someone had posted an image in the subs Discord comparing Tennessee numbers to one of the other states. I think it was Kentucky that had locked down a little bit. Yeah, you don't need to test when almost everyone has it. Yeah, comparing it to Kentucky and showing, like, what the numbers look like difference by taking responses. I've actually been really, I didn't have, like, a very strong opinion of our current Illinois governor, who we elected in 2018, and his responses to, yeah, his responses to everything have been pretty on point. He's been fairly proactive, which is good, in my opinion. I feel like this Vampires deck is kind of like the Jund deck of this Pioneer format. It's got, like, pretty efficient interaction, Thought Seizes. It's got some creatures that generate a little bit of card advantage while they do what they do. Sorin's not quite Liliana the Veil, but it's a planeswalker that provides a little bit of removal and utility. Todd said almost word for word that about 10 minutes ago. Great minds, all that jazz. Trudeau is getting backlash for his response up here with how long he left the borders open. Yeah, that doesn't surprise me. I assume most of the world where reasonable people are largely exist, like, would be embarrassed or scared by the response that's happened here in the United States. Trump's response was nowhere near quick enough. Lumbering Falls, thanks for 17 months. Welcome back. I appreciate that. What's going on, Dwight? We are playing in a streamer tournament coordinated by Todd Anderson put it together. We're currently watching Bloody play against Chris Kvartek. Their match is the last match going on in this first round. We lost round one to Saffron Olive playing enchantments. Olive's enchantment deck is actually probably pretty reasonable against this mono black deck. They likely can't take a Sphere of Safety off the table. Again, surprises me that Saffron elected not to play four Sphere of Safety in the main. It just seemed like the best card in that archetype when we played it. Maddox Bass, thank you for the brand new Prime support. I appreciate that. Welcome to Oaklandia. For people that enjoy my content and are around more on the weekends, or around more on the weekends than during the week, my schedule is going to be changing moving forward. I'm not going to be doing weekend afternoons like this, but I am planning to start streaming Saturday and Sunday starting in the morning. So tomorrow I will be live at about 8 a.m. Central Standard Time when I normally go live. And I'm going to do my normal like 8 to 2 or 3 schedule with Pioneer or Magic Online to start into Standard into Historic. So as long as my wife and my children and I are mostly locked up in the house and they're not going to school, I'm going to be live on the weekends and taking 2 days off during the week moving forward. Yeah, I have some fears that I hope end up being unfounded, that like the hashtag America attitude that we have in this country, you know, it's my freedom, you can't tell me I'll do what I want, is gonna make it harder for things to get in check here. Yeah, there were a number of senators that ended up doing stock trading stuff, right? I think there was a Democrat, too. I think there were two or three GOP senators that did it, and then one Democrat. Yeah, it was... I don't care if they were a GOP senator or a Democrat. All of them should lose their seats. They should all face criminal charges. I'm not biased. Wrong is wrong. All of them should be gone. I don't care if they have a D or an R next to their name. I believe it was four. I believe there were three GOP senators and one that was a Democrat. Losing their seats should be the minimum. Feinstein was the Democrat, and her stock wasn't a blind trust, apparently. I don't understand what the nuance is there with that. We're doing all right, C-Lab. Playing lots of Switch games with the kids. She can't make decisions about a blind trust. Okay, so that if her stocks were actually in a blind trust, then that's... I feel like all senators, if they own stock, should be required to put all of their investments into blind trusts. I feel like senators having any money they control in stocks makes them incredibly biased and unable to do their job impartially. We lost to Saffron Olive playing enchantments. This Bloody versus Kvartek match is the last match of the round. Pretty bad, King Koopa. Like most of the fun decks we play for a second time in Pioneer, it feels pretty rare that we play a sweet deck for the second time through and our opinion doesn't sour on it. So we had a good run with Merfolk the first time we played it, and then I kind of intentionally didn't play it again because I didn't want my opinion to sour on it before today. But we lost to Saffron, and then we played a league match and then lost another one. It's fine. Today's about doing hopefully something good. We hit the minimum goal. I set the total goal for 5,000. I'd be a little surprised if we get there so close to the St. Jude stream we did recently, but Christy and I promised to match the first $1,000 worth of donations, so we'll at least double up what we've already raised. The St. Jude stream raised like a little over $12,000. It was an incredible number. I was going to hold off on doing another charity thing for a little bit since that was so successful. And I figured a number of people in the community would be tapped out, but this came along that Todd was putting together and extraordinary circumstances in the world. Yeah, that doesn't surprise me, Tongzi. I expect the viewer count will be low today too. It's kind of an off time slot for me, and Magic Online content tends to be a little bit less popular than Magic Arena content. And there's downtime in between matches and stuff like this. It's tough to really do good commentary over the top of a match because we can't see both hands. It's a real shame Moto doesn't have like an official spectator mode for things like this that we can't utilize. As always, if you're ever wondering when you can expect to see me online, you can always find my schedule on my website. Always put that up there in advance. Why Merfolk? Because it's one of the decks I most recently had fun playing. In Pioneer, I don't know. And people have been watching the stream and watching me play Pioneer on the stream know that I'm not a huge fan of Pioneer at the moment. The format really soured for me personally with the release of Theros. Let's see if we can speed this up. Ranting Bob has pledged that he'll match the second $1,000. Alrighty. Well, thank you, Bob, for your absurd generosity in all things always. And Bob, for those of you that aren't familiar, Bob's one of Hooglandia's whales. He's definitely good for it. I'm gonna tweet that to encourage other people to get in here. Hip hop for Bob. Thank you for the 2/3 of a year, Zingzal. Bits unfortunately do not work for the charity thing. You have to donate using the Tiltify link because the money for the charity thing doesn't go through me personally. All right, sweet. So their match is done. That was the last match. We'll have the next one coming up here momentarily. It's the way charitable donations work in the US. If I collected money from people and then paid it out for myself personally, I would have to pay taxes on all of the money I take in because the amount of money an individual person has to donate in a year to be able to write off what they donate on their taxes versus the standard deductible is an astronomical amount. Basically, philanthropy laws in the United States as they exist in regards to tax codes explicitly exist for billionaires and millionaires to avoid paying taxes on certain amounts of money. Because a lot of those people donate large amounts of money to organizations that they own, basically. Not all of them, but that's a lot of the screwiness on it. Try this link, Tupto. Ah, 12-6. I too have killed the monsters on 12-6 a couple of times. Anonymous, thanks for your $20 donation. Whoa, I think there was a big one in there that I missed. Where's my dashboard? Today is not double dipping into the deck queue. Demox, thank you for the very generous $200 donation. The deck queue is just already pretty backed up as is, and like inflating another couple thousands of dollars would just devalue almost everything in it. It gets astronomically harder as it goes along. Yeah, I assume Playhu. I played through the first 52 weeks fairly easily. I'd assume it gets more challenging as you get deeper into it. Thanks for the $10 contribution, Pterodactyl. Every little bit counts. What's going on, Phantom? Year two is almost completely impossible. Yeah, they're in early access. So I wouldn't be surprised if they need to balance things a little bit. I didn't start the second year at all. The first year we cleared pretty easily. I think the heroes only got to my actual thing at the end a couple of times. Even the champions on the last week didn't get to my boss monster or whatever it's called at the end. I have no idea, GD squared. I'm not super familiar with that genre in general. Hey, Mikey, thanks for the contribution. It's definitely sweet. It might not be good, but sweet definitely qualifiers. The 10-ton hammer, thanks for the contribution. Whoa! The website talked to me and told me that there was a new pairing. I wasn't prepared for this level of technology. This MTG Melee site's pretty sweet. Maybe if Channel Fireball uses something like this, their tournaments won't suck on Magic Arena. Like, running Magic tournaments on Smash was, like, really awkward and clunky. But this site that's, like... I think anybody can put tournaments up on this. And, like, their deck list just, like, appears down the left side. You, like, just click on player names here to show who won which match results. I can click over here. There's a chat box with my opponent if I need to talk to them here on the website. It's really, really pretty slick. Seems like they've thought through all the things that you would want to. I think I have to add a buddy to challenge. Challenge player. They might need a second too. Kvartek was one of the person playing the last match. I think it's Swiss then top 8. I don't actually 100% know. Dispersed me. Thanks for contributing $20. I appreciate that. So for those of you that are just joining us for raising money for COVID relief for people who are going to need extra help during these economically uncertain times, very, very generously, Ranting Bob in chat has promised to match the second $1,000 worth of donation. So if we make it to $2,000 on the total there today, Bob's going to kick us up to three. Christy and I pledged to match the first $1,000. And Bob generously... pledge to match the second. Having our one drop here is great. Someone was asking how many Merfolk Lord are in this format. It's not many is the answer. For Big Red Historic Mission. Sounds good, Reason. I'll get that out after I'm all done streaming today. Yeah, the fact, honestly, there's a good chance Merfolk is just better in Pioneer than it is, or in Historic than it is in this format, because we got the Miro Regery in Historic. Yep. Well, we got Lords, chat. Lords. Winning the die roll is good. Missing our land drop is less good. Hopefully they just play Murderous Rider here as a 2-3. And then we get to play the second. Well, that's terrifying. So they're going to play a 4-4 here then. Oh, okay. Yeah, that's a good line. Kvartek's real good for a reason. This is Chris Kvartek. I believe they're in the MPL this cycle. They had a bunch of insane runs at arena tournaments last year. They're at the very least in Rivals. They might have been directly into the MPL. I don't know. The whole organized play system on Wizard's side is very not straightforward. He's in the MPL. Look at that. We are accurate. Thanks for contributing, Lumbering Falls. Yep. Feeling pretty dead. This can cast as though it had flash. If we pay two more, it returns a tapped creature to its owner's hand. Not particularly exciting. They've got four cards. They're at 15. They've got the Sorin. If we bust out of this event quickly, maybe we'll play a historic deck or two. I don't have anything already prepared, but wouldn't take too long to get put together. I think I'm just going to Harbinger of the Tides here and tell him to pick this up. No, we'll see. We'll see how long that takes too, though, because, like, even if we lose this round quickly, like, with the waiting, we're going to be live for a little bit. Yeah, all this lifelink's just going to bury us very quickly. We're already through three of our Merfolk Lords. Like, we don't really have a way to make our things bigger. They're going to start powering up their things. Yeah. Yeah, we're pretty dead. Yeah, Historic's definitely exceeded expectations. Historic Anthology 2, I feel like, ended up being quite fantastic. Been pretty happy with it. Hey, Silipharian, thanks for the $15. I appreciate that. Thanks for contributing to a good cause. So I think I want the Trap Weavers as some tempo for their lifelinkers. Vivian sounds good to generate a little bit of card advantage with. What do I actually want to cut, though? They have a lot of spot removal, so Warden of the Wave seems pretty reasonable. Because they have a lot of spot removal, trimming Thassa doesn't seem terrible. So I haven't built the Fall of the Thran deck yet, Bob. I need to sit down and go through Scryfall for that. It's going to be up tomorrow. The Wizard Retorts are probably cuttable, huh? I probably don't really have time to hold up this effect. Let's just cut three of those. I think a Thassa and three of these sounds reasonable. I'm boarding in a couple of non-creatures, so cutting some non-creatures to keep my creature count up for Collected Company sounds appealing. Easy mulligan. Yeah, this is a fine keep. Silvergill Adept kind of unmulligans us in a way. It's a threat that picks up another card. Wouldn't be surprised to see Silvergill Adept leave here, since it's like kind of a 2-for-1. I think I'm actually just going to go ahead and loot here. There's still airplanes flying. Hey, Topto. Thanks for your generous contribution. Yep. Land? So we'll go Trickster, tap your Aetherborn, attack you for 2. And then next turn we can go Harbinger, bounce your Aetherborn, attack you for 4, assuming they have nothing else. Seems like a low probability though. Oh wait, this isn't Trap Weaver. Right? This untaps. I was thinking it doesn't untap, I was thinking of this one. Well, you know. What are lands? Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me no more. Hellboy, thanks for the 25 months. I appreciate that. Welcome back. Make Bob broke again. Getting close, Bobby. This is the donate link here. Them missing a land is good for us. Means they're not going to be able to get too far ahead here. Trap Weaver is going to come down, and this one doesn't untap, so that's good. So this will diddle that one, and it won't undiddle next turn. Let's smack them for 4 here again, which might make them pump the brakes on this one finally. All these lifelink creatures is pretty impossible to race, though. Our deck not having evasion like spirits does being a pretty big drawback here. Both the opponents we played against able to just pretty successfully gum the board up against us in a real awkward way. Huh? Okay, I think at this point, I'm just, like, passing and, like, just, like, end-stepping Brazen Borrowers here to try and close things out in the air. I think is the plan. Hey, Hellboy, thanks for your very generous contribution. Yep. And these, even just 1, 2, 3 life blinkers, could be a real challenge to race. They have any amount of removal to follow it up. Kalitas, yep. Let's go down to 13 here, flash this in. Just mono black life blinkers. Alright, let's shock that in there, so that way we can flash in Harbinger of the Tides at instant speed. If they attack with Kalitas next turn, we can send it back to their hand. They have like a Murderous Rider here in response to this trigger. Gonna put us in a pretty medium spot. Yeah, last time we played this deck, we drew Collected Company and Thassa a whole bunch. And I think that distinction is feeling pretty relevant here today. Like, just our inability to, like, break through these stalled boards. Yeah, it just very did. Let's play another league match here. See if we can get on the scoreboard yet today. We're just gonna keep getting our poor little Finn smushed. The problem with like Kumena is it's just too slow and fair for this format nap time. Like, by the time you get Kumena going, you might as well, you're gonna be dead most of the time. Thistle AM, thanks for the 2/3 of a year. Welcome back. I appreciate the Prime support. Yeah, Geodude, seems like the bare minimum. I'm very fortunate to be in a spot where not only where my job hasn't been impacted, but Christy's able to work from home too. So the only way we're gonna get through this whole disaster is if people are decent to each other. Which reminds me, if you haven't called or emailed your congressional representatives to encourage them to help us be decent to each other via government assistance, you should definitely do that. If you're in another country, you should call whatever your equivalent is and let them know the same. Although most non-US countries have stepped up far more than the US has, unsurprisingly. Spreading Seas is good because in Modern, there are merfolk that give your merfolk island walk. So Spreading Seas makes your creatures unblockable, basically. Thassa fills a similar role here when she shows up. But she's not been showing up for us so far today. And I think that's the big difference. If you go back and watch the league where we played this, where it felt okay, we drew Thassa a whole bunch. And we drew Collected Company a whole bunch into Thassa. And that really made things come together. So Silvery Lineup's a great card to draw here after we've mulliganed. So attack before we cast our spells, so that way they don't want to block, because I want to cast Silver Galette up tier. An anonymous $50 donation there. Thank you to whoever you, anonymous spooky ghosts are. Yep, Spreading Seas also occasionally gets free wins by locking people off their mana for sure. Looking like something mono green here. Our slew of Tidebinder mages in the board, likely going to be useful. What's not going to be great, again, though, is the fact that, like, we're sitting here and the board state is just getting super gummed up again. Again, just the fact that, like, we're playing a tribal deck that's similar to Spirits, but is relying on attacking on the ground, not looking stellar in this format. It might be a Collected Company deck, too, here. You are not alone, Snowstorm. I think I'm just supposed to Thassa and pass here. Pretty sure we're going to get Collected Company. This green-black company deck with Rotting Regisaur in it has been making the rounds. I don't think I want to run my fish headlong into an ambush. Yep. Like, maybe Thassa could sneak through damage here. Like, she stabilizes the board relatively okay on her own, which is decent. Just gonna go wide enough to attack around Thassa here before long. I think I'm gonna bottom that. If I find a land, I really want it to be untapped here. And if we find a spell, that's okay too. I think I'm just gonna go ahead and play Biomancer and pass here. I kind of expect my opponent to attack next turn. And if they don't attack, well, I'll just activate Benthic Biomancer. I mean, I don't think it really matters if we're testing enough to be in the top three just lucky, because, like, we're almost assuredly in the top three based on the percentage of tests we've done to the percentage of the population that we have. They just have not had the testing capability, in large part due to Trump burying his head in the sand and not wanting the testing capability. Yeah, we're just super dead. Their god is better than our god. The green people worship the mightier being. I'm going to board in these four Tidebinder Mages. I'm going to cut these, let's cut the two Cuplas and two Wizard's Retorts here. They don't really have much removal in their archetypes, so this effect's not super useful. A couple Wizard's Retorts seem fine. We can occasionally hold them up with like a Brazen Borrower or a Collected Company. Sure. Trump doesn't want to test unless he owns it and can sell it. That's probably sad but true. Last week, experts were predicting that the peak of cases in the United States was still 10 to 14 weeks out. So, like, I'd assume that's true of I'd assume that's true of places like Canada too right now. Tidebinder Mage locking down the elf sounds great here, especially with the Wizard's Retort as a drop. Means they won't be able to play a 3-drop this turn, and then we'll get told up Retort next turn. If we hit green mana on curve for this Collected Company, we could be in a very good spot here. Again, play versus the draw being a huge discrepancy in most Magic formats. Offer the trade here. If they need the elf, they might take it. No dice. So we've got Retort, Borrower, and Tricky Dick here. We can't flash this in because it's a 2-mana upcharge to do so. How's it going so far? Like most sweet decks we've played for a second time in Pioneer, this one's kind of fallen apart. So I think I actually just let this Registrar resolve, end step, Trickster, tap it. I don't actually think I want to trade with the Skooze either. I think I just keep attacking them here. Untapped land? That could be an untapped land. I think I'm going to go ahead and play Silver Galad up tier. If we hit the untapped land, we can like Harbinger the Scavenging Ooze back to their hand. People trying to profit off of the whole COVID pandemic is like peak late stage capitalism issues. Being of combat, if you control a creature with 4 power or greater, put a 1/1 counter on this. That's cute. So we'll take like 10 here. I think we're just done, right? Yeah, I'm gonna drop this league. We'll play another match or two in the actual event, but I'm gonna be done trying to make this deck work. No, Nyreen, it's just like a low stakes, mostly for entertainment purpose thing, so that's what most people defaulted to. I personally haven't really enjoyed much of Pioneer lately. This was one of the last decks we played that I really like. I was like, oh, this is neat and seems fun to play. And then, like, it's just been a complete and total dumpster fire the second time through today, which probably means we just ran a little bit good the last time we played it. Like I said, last time we played it, we like drew a lot of Thassa's, drew a lot of collected companies, and it felt pretty reasonable. And today it's just been like super clunky and awkward. You like lose die rolls and get behind very quickly. That's great, top 10 hammer. Just don't screw around at all. Hey, Rogue, thanks for the 45 months. I appreciate that. Welcome back. Thanks for keeping me around. What are we doing? Let's pull up some coverage of what other people are playing. Numot is just playing straight inverter. Would it be played on Monday? What on God's green earth is going on here? Let's take a peek, shall we? Oh, is he watching? Oh, he's already done and he's watching someone else's stream. He's like, that doesn't look like Nassif's deck. Let's grab Jim Davis's channel. Looks like he has something crazy going on. So I'm actually going to be live tomorrow. Holy guacamole tacos. Starting this weekend, I'm going to be streaming Saturdays and Sundays, and I'm going to be taking 2 days off during the week as opposed to taking off on the weekends. So that way, Christy and I can alternate doing some extra activities with the kids because they've been watching a lot of television and playing a lot of video games this last week while they were home and Christy and I were both working from home. So, wanna mitigate some of that. Make sure we're doing some educational stuff with them still while they're out of school. Yeah, he's playing Risen Reef plus Young Pyromancer. Seems slick. Has Chandra Acolyte of Flame too? That's great. The charity command is wrong. I forgot there was a charity command. I'm just gonna delete that. That was for the last charity stream we did. Donate is the command. So, Christy and I matched the first out. We're going to match the first $1,000 donation that we got, which we cleared out of ourselves. And then Ranting Bob in chat very generously volunteered to match the second $1,000 worth of donation. So, if we get to $2,000 total on the bar up top, Bob's going to kick in another grand. Thanks, Halfquarter. Glandia mods are great. Make Bob broke again. And then actually, I think Christy's got to double check her work stuff, but Christy was pretty sure that the company that she works for matches charitable donations by their employees up to a certain dollar amount each year. So I think if we make our donation in her name, they're going to match some amount of it from her, the company that she works for. Sounds good. Guacamole tacos, what I said was I'm going to be live tomorrow. It's WotC matching anything. No, Wizard of the Coast is in no way, shape, or form associated with the event that we're running today. This was put together by Strong Sad, Todd Anderson, who does commentary for SCG, among other things. Yeah, not surprised to see him just pass here. I feel like you want to wait to play the Risen Reach until you have a spell pierce up. This is like the Fires of Invention turn. Now he has to decide, like, does he want a stroke or does he want a pierce here? Facebook will match yours as well. That's great, Bob. Yeah, a lot of big orgs do that. Christy. I think the company she works for is technically a Fortune 50 company. I don't know. They're huge though. I forget which of the two. There's a big difference there. Fortune 50 or 500 means like they're in the top X companies in the country. Generally speaking. Hey, Vona. Thanks for contributing. I appreciate that. Oh, I missed one. Ryan the Mime. Thank you for the $100 donation as well. Did I miss any others? For the people hurting much more than me, thank you. Oh, they're commenting with these two. I didn't realize there were comments on this thing. I guess that makes sense. You can always type exclamation point record in chat to find out what our record is, regardless of what event we're playing in. What is the text on Gideon's intervention? Name a card. Your opponent can't cast spells with the chosen name. Prevent all damage to be dealt to you by that card. Is that card even that good? What's the resolution on this, by the way? Why is it in 480p? I was like, I can barely read this Gideon intervention. Why are we on potato quality? This actually works out pretty good for Jim, because he gets to, like, Mystic Repeal this Chain to the Rocks now, and, like, get his Risen Reef back and get another trigger. Castle Embrith seems really sweet in the opponent's archetype, or in Jim's archetype, because it can make all their tokens bigger, whether they're Young Pyromancer or Saheeli. Oh, value. So now he gets to Chandra, make a Saheeli token. Oh, he gets to Saheeli copy Risen Reef, and then Chandra draw four. That's great. Yeah, loving every minute of it. Hey, Reed, thanks for the contribution. Let's get Bob's cash, putting us over the threshold. An evangelical pastor told a group of pastors some news that the government was going to apply martial law tomorrow, and one of the pastors created a WhatsApp audio which went viral. This morning, the supermarkets and gas stations were in total chaos. Yeah. Also, like, even if any form, something that a lot of people don't get, why there's these constant runs, like these panic runs on supermarkets unnecessarily, like, even if things do go into more of a lockdown state, you're still going to be able to leave your house to get essentials. When these, like, shelter-in-place orders happen and things like that, like, people are still leaving their houses to get things they need to live. It just means you can't go to the gym. You can't, like, go to the trampoline park anymore. They're closing libraries, stuff like that. Things that are deemed non-essential services. Grocery stores, pharmacies, these types of things are going to remain open. Gosh, and he just gets to, like, draw 700 cards again this turn? You the best, Bob? Oh, essential. Yeah, they're going to close the GameStops. What it actually means is they're going to close the GameStops. Can Jim deal lethal here? So Jim has 5, 6, 7, and then this is 8, 9, and then he can slash for 2. Yeah, he should have lethal here, right? Why didn't he just make elemental tokens with haste? Is he forgetting about the castle? Yeah, I think Jim might have forgotten about the castle here. Because castle, he's just so excited he could draw more cards. He just, like, doesn't want to kill them. Or, like, miss that he can kill them. All right, his opponent conceded. I mean, drawing lots of cards is way better than not, right? By the way, if you think Jim's deck list is sweet in the exclamation point tournament command, you can find a link to the tournament on the MTG Melee site that has all the deck lists easily accessible and ready to export for you. He's playing video games between rounds. Makes sense. He's drafting between rounds. Makes sense. Also drafting between rounds. Round might actually be almost done. I think all the matches are done, actually. Sweet. That's one of the upsides to Pioneer being kind of brutal right now. Is the matches are likely to go quickly. So that's nice. It was like a 30-minute round, if that. Look at that. All right, we're playing against Allie Warfield here, who is playing Sultai Delirium. All right. Do paper tournaments have early ends as well? Occasionally, if they have... Oh. Why aren't you copying my clipboard, Moto? If all the matches actually finish, but yeah, usually paper tournaments are big enough that's not really an option. Usually there's always someone that goes to time. All right, it's playing against Allie Warfield, who's playing Sultai Delirium. Another kind of fishy hand here. Think it's not bad. Gotta collect a company until we get Thoughtseize. Ay, 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 feels Pioneer Man. Do, 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 do. I will say this, with Pioneer Masters coming to Arena and then Historic later this year, I'm really not looking forward to this card getting added to the format. One of the things I really like about Pioneer in its current state, or Historic in its current state, is that there's no Thoughtseize in it. Now we're gonna give an honest try at this third match. Had two rough sets against some things. We'll see if we can hold our own a little bit against the mid-range deck. And if we die, we die, and we'll bow out. It'll be great. Raised over $2,000 for a good cause. $3,000 once Bob chips in. The amount that he promised that we know he's good for. I think I'm just putting this Harbinger into play. Doesn't bounce anything, but I just, like, need a creature. Cavern of Souls? I really hope not. That card's such a stain. We were talking about, though, I think Aether Vial would be a sweet card for them to print directly into Historic. I think that would be like a good Historic anthology card for them to consider. Brazen Borrower is an excellent pickup here. They're adding Thoughtseize Historic. Well, there's supposed to be a Pioneer Master set releasing this year on Magic Arena. And the Pioneer Master set will be included in Historic, because Historic is every card on Arena sans things that get banned. Three color tap, three color lands. I don't know that those are really a useful inclusion, because they're not really constructed playable. FNM is essential. If you want to support your local game store, buy some singles, buy a gift card. I'm sure if they're smart, they sell gift cards. Do not go and play FNM right now. FNM and paper magic in general is an incredible disease vector during normal times. Like, you're handling cards that someone else shuffled constantly. Even with everyone having good hygiene, playing paper magic is kind of scummy. And let's be honest, we all know there's plenty of people at your local game store that don't have good hygiene. I'm sure some or even most of them do, but yeah. Well, eventually they plan to bring all of Pioneer to Arena. So... correct. It only takes one. Sure, J-Man. I agree with you there. It'd be good with Field of the Dead. I don't know that Field of the Dead needs extra help, though. No, Pioneer Masters, for those that haven't been keeping up on Arena news, is going to be an Arena-only set that will serve to print an initial batch of Pioneer cards into Arena as they slowly work towards putting all of Pioneer on Arena. That's actually a very good draw. Might actually tempo them out of this game. So, they found an Uro with their Traverse. If they cast your Uro here, we're just going to let it resolve and we'll plan to retort it when they escape it. No, they didn't publish a public timeline, which honestly I think is a good thing. In my opinion, as someone who's done software and like uses a lot of software, I greatly prefer when companies keep their strict deadlines internal, because I would rather a company release their software late rather than release it early and have it not be ready when they release it. In the end, Historic will become Pioneer. It won't become Pioneer. So, one, Historic already has a number of cards in it that aren't Pioneer legal. Two, Historic has a number of cards in it that are Pioneer legal, or that are in sets that would be in Pioneer, but are banned in Pioneer. The main issue with Pioneer in its current state, in my opinion, is the lack of ban list management. And they've already shown us that Historic is going to have its ban list managed in a way that's different than Pioneer has had its ban list managed. The fact that they unbanned something in Pioneer in Historic already is huge. One of my big complaints about this format isn't just that they turned it into mostly a combo fest. It's that they turned it into a combo fest, but then also left a number of things banned that no longer need to be banned. Like, you want to leave all these brutal Theros combos legal? That's fine, but then unban Felidar Guardian and unban Felidar Guardian and unban Field of the Dead and probably unban a few other things, honestly. Like Smuggler's Copter, that could come back. Like Once Upon a Time and Veil of Summer are the only things that I would say with certainty, those cards suck, leave them gone. Everything else should be considered to return to the format. I honestly think you could talk about Oko. I think Oko in a world without once and a world without Veil is probably pretty reasonable. This format is fairly high power level, all things considered. Losing our Lord here is pretty brutal. We're a little bit short of lethal at this point, so I could Brazen Borrower the Murderous Rider, fire up this, and then put them to one. Is that the line? It's probably not the line because they just like hit us with Uro next turn. They already have four cards back in their Binnegan already because of Seder Wayfinder. So I think my plan here is just like land pass, we'll Borrower the Uro and then play Borrower at end of turn. Sure, but I could list like 600 different things that I don't really like that have play patterns in this format, Golden Ringer. I think I don't like the play patterns isn't a very good reason to leave something banned. When they banned Field of the Dead, I was kind of iffy, but I thought it was fine in large part due to the fact that it seemed like they were going to make this format slower and more fair. And it feels like that's no longer the case. It feels like if the format's not going to be slow and fair, Field of the Dead is fine because Field of the Dead is too slow against most things. I would also be happy if they just ban a bunch of the combo decks in this format. But again, my problem isn't that it's combo based. It's that they've kind of waffled in the middle. I want them to just like pick a lane and stick with it. That is such a good draw. Well, ain't got time to play around a removal spell here, so driving in my Merfolk, beep beep. So they're going to 10 here with this block because Ryder has lifelink. Yeah, this is game one. They're trading off Mutavault. They don't have a sweeper in their main deck, do they? Nope, doesn't look like it. I have no idea, Delta. I haven't played much of this format. Actually, I've enjoyed Modern a lot more than Pioneer the last couple of times we played Modern. So they get to escape Uro here. What do I like in Modern at the moment? We played Kiki Chord last time we played Modern. It was a lot of fun. I'm a sucker for Kiki Chord. If you didn't watch the Kiki Chord video and you've liked Modern here historically, you should definitely be checking my favorites deck playlist on my website every single day that I stream. Because you're missing some good ones up there if you're not checking the favorite decks list. Well, I mean, so if I attack with everything, they go block, block, they go up to 10, they take 8, they go to 2, but then they get some zombies. I think questions like that are kind of pointless, Blackheart. I think they're not questions that I can really answer objectively, so me speculating on them doesn't really serve any functional purpose. Yeah, I'm kind of inclined to agree with that. People just tend to play good decks that are good in every format. We'll see if they're able to removal spell enough of our stuff here to keep Thassa from killing them or not. Thassa can pay two mana to make things unblockable, including herself. If they have Dubs removal spell here in four cards, we're probably going to be up a creek without a paddle. But if they don't have Dubs removal spell, we might be able to run them down here. No, they're not transparent at all with their goals. 177. Yeah, the Kiki League is ASMR for the first hour. Fair warning. Ishkana is very good. They're dead on board though, right? So they have to have a removal spell, right? If they don't have Fatal Push here, they're dead. Are we gonna do it, chat? Are we gonna get on the scoreboard? We talked about how this deck had felt kind of bad today, and in part, I said I felt it likely was probably doing kind of poorly because we hadn't been drawing Thassa, and like Thassa really just like showing us why she's worth her weight there. And that kind of evasion, similar to how Island Walk works in the modern version of this deck, seems good. Should we have given... Oh, that's a good point. Borrower couldn't have been pushed there. Yeah, good call. 10 out of 10 should have targeted Borrower because it wasn't pushable. Yep. Push is casually a kill 4 or less in my mind, but in this format, it doesn't usually do that as often. Is this a Tidebinder Mage matchup or a Harbinger of the Tides matchup? I think it might actually be a Tidebinder Mage matchup. Hey, G-Man. Welcome to a live one. For folks who can't watch during the week that are hanging out here enjoying some Hoaglandia live, starting tomorrow, I'm going to be streaming on the weekends for the duration of the pandemic conditions that we're currently in. As long as my kids are off school, I'm going to be streaming on the weekends moving forward. I'm going to be taking a couple of days off during the week. I think I want Vivian to generate card advantage here. Maybe I just trim a couple of retorts. I don't think I really want to be super reactive in this matchup. I think leaving in a pair is probably fine, though, to catch them on occasion. Yeah, one of the reasons why I generally don't stream on the weekends is because streaming against large Magic events tends to hammer the viewer count down. But without those going on for the foreseeable future, makes sense for us to do a little bit of that. I've heard that videos on YouTube mentioning Corona have been demonetized. Is that the case for you? I don't know if YouTube tells me when they demonetize me. I can go check. I wonder if they're like actively listening to like all the audio for the word Corona, or if like they're just doing ones that are specifically focused on that topic. Cause like my videos aren't tagged with anything COVID related, right? We just like happen to talk about it while we're playing. offer a trade here because I don't think they're going to take it. And then I'm going to go ahead and play Warden of the Waves to be mana efficient. And then next turn I can play second Tidebinder to tap down this Tireless Tracker. And even if YouTube was listening, I'm like demonetizing things that mention it. Like you said, like YouTube ad revenue is such a small percentage of my income, it wouldn't really change how I do things here. I think any and all mentions are automatically being demonetized. I'll have to go back and double check, but I'm pretty sure nothing I've done has been listed as demonetized so far. Ready to swim with the fishes, Tireless Tracker? Well, that's just rude. Alright, petty theft it is. Harsh, but fair. Living that quarantine life, watching baseball reruns and Magic Online stream. 6 to 14 months, Aaron. Glad you're staying safe out there. So there's a Languish in Warfield's bin here. Are there sweepers they bring in out of the sideboard? Just a Miser Languish. Languish is their only sweeper. So I actually just like straight up don't have to worry about it, which is great. Collected Company. I think I am in fact in love with the Coco. I am not in love with the Coco. I lied. We have a very bad relationship. I'm filing for divorce. I am in fact divorcing the Collected Company. Strong emotions, remembering why we don't play this card. So what you get for voluntarily registering Collected Company, right? And we're just like super dead to this Ishkana, right? I guess this collected company could steal the game. If Collected Company finds Thassa, Thassa can kill them next turn. So hopefully they tap out for something that doesn't gain them life. We company, we find Thassa plus thing, we make some stuff unblockable, and we kill them next turn. That seems to be this deck's line to being able to win games. Just like draw Thassa, punk people out. Rest of what we have going on is pretty middling. No blocks, down 15. Opponent is now clueless. Also missing their second black source is worth noting. They're through two fatal pushes and one abrupt decay. They still have trophy and stuff like that left in their deck. Uro is very, very good here. Gets them up to 10. It means Thassa's not lethal next turn. There's their second black source. And they shocked it in. So they have... No! No! Oh! Oh, I just clicked through that. Oh, it was like, there was a second of client lag when I hit it during their second main phase, so I hit it again, and then it passed at their end of turn. Yikes. All right, low stakes tournament. It's okay. We're gonna be okay, chat. Everything's gonna be all right. It's fine, we drew another Collected Company. We did it intentionally. We knew the Collected Company was on the top of our deck. Hey, Paula. Thanks for contributing. I appreciate that. Okay. I mean, sure. See, our misclick baited them into the full attack here. They probably didn't think we had the collected company because we did nothing last turn. All right. One good misplay deserves another. Listen, we've all been there, chat. We've all fatal pushed the thing that wasn't about to die to the fatal push. So, fatal push is templated in a weird way that it can target things it doesn't kill. So it says, if this thing, then this other thing. All right, Dasa, fireball them. So they can escape Uro next turn. They can, Hostage Taker is a triggered ability, so it doesn't have to pay the tax on this, but I can Brazen Borrower the Hostage Taker in response to its trigger. That's true. It does let you kill Phantasmal Image things that are copying 5 or 6 drops. So, because Hostage Taker is templated as a single trigger here, I can respond to this with Petty Theft, and my thing will never get exiled. Now, if they have an untapped land here, they can shot play that and then re-Hostage Taker Thassa. Yep, down to one. So, top deck Thassa is lethal. Land into collected company Thassa is lethal. Right, because they have six blockers. All right, so we get six shots at another Thassa here. We didn't find anything to tap their blockers here, unfortunately. Do I just take double Silvergill Adept? And just like try and draw to Thassa for next turn? I think that's the play. Go fish. At least one Thassa in the bottom earlier from a collector. Maybe that's not true. The first company just found one creature. Oh, the second one found two Thassas. You're right. Yeah, you're totes right. So they have an Uro they can escape here. So right now, every threat we have is lethal. But when Uro escapes, they jump up to four life, which makes that no longer be the case. Yep, that kills a Silvergill Adept every single turn. Oh, that's an activated ability though, right? It costs them 2 mana to do it? Sick. Because this doesn't target... For some reason, this taxes activated abilities and not triggered abilities, which is really weird. Like, usually it does both. Yeah, so if they... Unless they have an untapped land here, they can't Liliana and escape Uro. Which I wonder if they missed that. That might be our saving grace. Warden of the Waves here might be... Might be the thing that lets us steal this. Yep. Yeah, in fact, the website we're using for this is a new site called MTG Melee that's really slick. Are they dead? I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 attackers. I tap this. They have 6 blockers. And they're at 1. I think Tricky Dick here is lethal, right? Let's say hey diddle diddle on that. Four, five, six, seven. One, two, three, four, five, six. All right. Look at that. We're on the scoreboard, chat. We're on the scoreboard. We 0-2 to League. We started 0-2 in the event. Don't call it a comeback. Chobo Robot, thank you for the third of the year. I appreciate that. Happy Saturday, folks. We found a Thassa and some collected companies. We found a Thassa and some collected companies, and we managed to win the game. That's nice. Will this go on the YouTubes? It will. It will go up on the YouTubes. It's a bad form to get delivery food during these times. So, my opinion on takeout is every time you're interacting with other people or they're interacting with your stuff, you're exposing yourself to a possible vector of disease transmission. From our understanding, from the CDC website, it can live on surfaces, I believe, for up to 3 days on some types of surfaces. So getting takeout means that you're giving yourself an exposure vector for 1 or 2 meals. So in general, you're exposing yourself less often if you're just getting your food at the grocery store for a couple of weeks. Because in that instance, you're going out and exposing yourself one time for a couple of weeks worth of meals, as opposed to exposing yourself for a couple of meals. So, Christy and I have not, as people who formerly lived on takeout effectively, we've been skipping takeout. Hey, Meebo. I'll make sure you have a sword while you're here, if you're ever around lurking the channel. Good games. Good luck in any of your future magic. Hope you had a good stream. I think your stance is irresponsible, Allure, and you're using laziness to avoid critical thinking skills. One of the reasons why we're going to have such a hard time dealing with COVID in the United States is in large part due to the fact that a lot of the government entities haven't really taken everything that we need to take, because they're trying to balance capitalism with a pandemic response. is basically the TLDR. Metafuse, thanks for the 13 months. I appreciate that. Welcome back. It's especially important to, like, recognize, it looks like his match is done already, that, like, the official recommendations vary state to state because the federal government run by the orange idiot in the White House has not had a consistent response. If you want to support your favorite local restaurants in this time, I would recommend buying gift cards. I would encourage you to buy gift cards rather than encouraging them to continue to have employees out and about. Your family member that hates most things progressive just said on Facebook that socialist programs are keeping Canadians afloat. Yeah, we're going to need more of that. Yes, gift cards. Gift cards are free loans. Look at that. The next round's up. Perfect. Marty, can you explain to me how you can say food-carrying devices are not a point of contact while also acknowledging that plastic, paper, and cardboard are points of contact and transmission? Because what is your food being carried in if it's not one of those three things? Like, can you explain to me? I don't understand. So, from my understanding of reading things, actual food isn't a point of transmission, but your food has to come in things, right? All right, we're playing against Aspiring Spike for the next match. They are playing a Karn the Great Creator, Idyllic Tutor. Oh, they're playing the Red White Fires deck that Jim was playing against. Okay, sweet. You don't get your food to air bubbles? I do not. My takeout generally does not come in air bubbles. You can always find the record by typing !record in chat. Thanks for the 21 months, Dom. I appreciate you keeping me around. Your husband is a librarian and his work was told the virus can live on paper for up to 5 days. Yeah, the more porous the surface, the longer it can live is my understanding of this, of what I've read. The record matters in this tournament? It really doesn't. The point of this tournament is the ticker above my head, which we've cleared over $2,000 for. And Christy and I are donating $1,000 to it. And then Ranting Bob, one of the crowns in chat, promised to match the second $1,000. So we're winning on the metric that counts. Yes, yeah, this is a tournament the same way FNF. This is a show tournament to encourage people that still have some means during this tough time to share some of those means. Did you lose a bet with the professor to have to play Merfolk today? Asking the real questions. I did not. I just had fun playing this deck last time we played it. And I wanted to try it again. Do they have a 3-mana sweeper? So they have a Sphere of Safety. They have Chained to the Rocks. There's no Deafening Clarion in their deck. So I'm just going to go ahead and play my Lord out here then. Yeah, Delta, I feel for you. I'm really hoping Congress can put aside their pettiness And Republicans can find it in their lack of heart to send stimuluses that our country's gonna need. So I think this turn I'm just passing and I want to hold Wizard's Retort up rather than play the Mistbinder. Because they're a Fires of Invention deck. And if they don't play Fires Out or something worth retorting, I can just adapt my Biomancer. Dawn of Hope. How many life gain sources does their deck have? It has Birth. I guess the Dawn technically makes tokens. Yeah, I guess I want to counter that. Oh, I only need 2 mana, right? Infinite jump blockers. It's self-enabling if the game's slow enough. Looking for an untapped land here. He says before breaking off. Hey. Burgerb, thank you for the half of your support. I appreciate that. Welcome back. All right. Thassa at least helps us cry, huh? I mean, like, triple collected company is, like, really good if we find a fourth land, huh? Oh, I forgot to change the scene to the mode of focus. Thank you. I appreciate the heads up there. They're, like, close enough out of the corner of my eye that I didn't notice. Feels Magic the Gathering, man. Now, the good news here is their graveyard doesn't have any creatures or planeswalkers to bring back at the moment. Gross. Glass Casket, yep. One of your finest Mutavaults, please, deck. Ghost Allison, thank you for the Brand New Prime support. I appreciate that. Welcome to Oglandia. Hope you're having a wonderful Saturday wherever you're at in the world. Listen, we'll take the tap land, okay? Beggars shan't be choosers, okay? We're desperate for a land. We'll take what we can get. At least they can't, like, get Ensnaring Bridge here, right? Glass half full. Are we in love with the Coco? We're about to find out. Whose team are you playing for, Collected Company? That's a big boat. Well, I could have companied on their turn, J-Man. So, like, on their following turn, it would have no longer been a thing. So, I think I'm just passing here. Anonymous, thanks for your contribution to the COVID Relief Fund. I could, like, be really aggressive and, like, company trying to find double Merfolk Trickster, but that's, like, pretty unlikely. Yeah, we're about to find 6 lands. Karn the Great Creator with the Sky Sovereign here is super good because this thing still triggers when it attacks, even if it's not crude. So I guess just, like, shoot down my Merfolk here whilst cracking us for 5. The boat's real good with Karn, for sure. Yep. All right, Coco. Don't fail me now. Who? Don't fail me now. All right. Tricky Dick. And, Harbinger could bounce the boat. But that's actually not that useful because the boat triggers when they cast it next turn, too. So I think I do this. Okay, Brazen Borrower is a very good draw. Nice, Snugglebear. Get it. We'll kill Karin here. And then we'll hope that these companies can drag us kicking and screaming across the finish line. And then this angel lets them crew the boat. I think we're probably dead here, huh? I'll company in response. We can find another tricky dick and tap the boat, but... Alright. Something. Living on a prayer. I don't know. I don't know how we ever beat Sigil, though. Probably can't. There's a lot. 22. If they draw, like, no spells for the rest of the game, and our collected companies are absurd, very dead. All right, so this is going to be another matchup where, like, we're boarding in Mystic Dispute is just, like, bad cancel. Kupla, again, is fine to trim here just because their removal doesn't get impacted by this. I think I'm going to trim Athassa. Then maybe I don't bring in all of these just because I don't want to go lower than 26 creatures for my companies, I don't think. Give this a go. I'm gonna keep this. Has our one drop. Brazen Borrower is probably one of our better cards in this matchup. JAC is Jeskai Ascendancy combo. You can find an example of it on my website. Let's fart this and try and hit our land drops here. You know, I'm actually just gonna get rid of that. Because I have so many instant speed things in my hand. Really hoping to draw a blue source here. Hit them with this and just pass. I could fire up Mutavault to get in for two more here, but I think I want a Petty Theft there 0-4 so I can keep pushing damage. Hey, Bowie, thank you for the year of support. I appreciate that. Let's get you a sword to go with that shield. Thanks for keeping me around. Feels Magic the Gathering, man. Mutavault, it's not free. Hey, Venithrax, thanks for the 2/3 of a year. I appreciate that. Hope you're having a wonderful weekend wherever you are in the world. Yep. It's about to name Mutavault. Could name Brazen Borrower here, too. Just Mutavault. Yep, this also. In addition to stopping us from casting spells with that name, it stops us, prevents damage from things of that source's name. It's about where they go, like, land, sigil, second enchantment. Yeah, I think we're probably done here. I think we were okay to miss the blue source on, like, turn 3, but just did at this point. We got the terms and conditions side of the creature lands. It's a good way to put it. All right, so unfortunately, a little bit disappointing end to the tournament in terms of deck quality, as has been the case with most brews in Pioneer. When it seems reasonable the first time through and we kind of shake the bushes on it the second time and play it a little bit more, the wheels tend to kind of fall off. I do feel like with the addition of Theros to this format, the format's become a lot more hostile to things that are kind of off the beaten path. I think in a lot of ways, this deck just is bad spirits in this format, just kind of like how Merfolk's been worse versions of other tribal decks and other formats. Historically speaking, a Priest of Gix, thanks for 19 months, welcome back. If you are a Merfolk lover, I am optimistic for Merfolk in Historic specifically. Murrow Reegery is a card in Historic that this build doesn't get to play here. That's very good in that format. I'm going to go ahead and call it a day. We're 1-3, which is dead for top 8 in the tournament. And big shout out to everybody that contributed to the COVID-19 Direct Relief donation drive today. I really appreciate all of that support. We raised over $2,000 from people here in chat. Bob said he's going to kick in another $1,000 to match the second $1,000 that we raised. Christy and I are going to kick in $1,000 ourselves. Just be decent to each other. There's a lot of people out there that are getting impacted by this that really didn't have any way to prepare for it. And if you have a little, give a level. Hopefully we're all gonna get through this together, huh? Social distance, all that jazz. I'm going to be back tomorrow morning at 8 a.m. Central Standard Time with my normal stream. Moving forward, I'm going to be streaming on Saturdays and Sundays while taking 2 different days off during the week. So that way I can spend some more time with the kids while not juggling them midstream as well. Thanks everybody for the understanding. As always, if you can't watch on the weekends consistently, it'll be up on my YouTube after the fact. I think Direct Relief, even if you don't donate through my link today, I did a little bit of research on them when Todd asked if I would do this, and they seem like they're one of the more reputable organizations. They do disaster relief response all over the world in general, and this money is specifically going to COVID-19 relief for people who are struggling because of what's going on in the world with that right now. Lord Aaron, thanks for the 10 months. I appreciate that. Welcome back. Thanks for keeping me around. And thanks to everybody that contributed. I'm going to go ahead and host Aspiring Spike. They were the ones with the sweet red-white deck that just knocked us out. I'm going to hit one more ad roll at the end here because I forgot to do that today because it's a little bit out of sorts, not used to streaming in the evening. But when I'm done, we'll be hosting them. So thanks everybody for watching, and I'll catch some of y'all tomorrow or later next week, hopefully. You ain't get worked right. That's awesome. Yeah, Chrissy, the donation Chrissy and I are going to make her work will match some of it too, which is awesome. One of the upsides of working for a big company. What does your title become? You get a horse to go with your to mount as a knight of Hooglandia. Get you later, Dorox. Everybody, enjoy the rest of your day.